Well, good morning and welcome to our service this morning. Can I, first of all, an apology. Tim was supposed to be leading this service and I'm afraid he's not well, and therefore you've got me. That also means that I'm sorry it won't be a communion service. Tim is hoping to be here on Wednesday for communion service at 11 o'clock. Now, after this service, the hall AGM meeting, and I've just asked Marie to come and tell us what's happening. Yes, please.
Morning, everyone. Just to let you know, obviously you've seen a lot of the building work that's been going on previously at the hall. Well, we're looking now to put in a new disabled toilet, a proper disabled toilet, into the hall, and that work's going to start at the end of July. So that's all part of a group that we've been belonged to for the last, oh my goodness, eight, probably nine. Yeah, it's a long time. So we've been raising lots of money to do work in the hall, and we've been gradually doing that work. So every year we have an AGM, which is part of being the group that we belong to, and that's today. So we've got our AGM today. So if you wanted to find out more about what's going on in the hall, you're more than welcome to come across. And also teas and coffees won't be at the back of the church today. They'll be over at the hall. And then if you want to stay and just listen to what's going on, you're more than welcome. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, Marie. So do go across for tea and coffee and find out what's going on if you can. Let's open with a prayer, shall we? Heavenly Father, we pray your peace into our hearts. Pray that you will speak to us through this service. Pray that you will lead us and may we join together in your love. In Jesus' name, amen. And we're going to begin with a hymn, "Oh, Praise the Name of the Lord our God." Thank you. join with these words. I pray that out of his glorious riches, God our Father may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all God's holy people, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Would you like to sit or kneel to pray? And we will use the collect for purity. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. And now we bring to mind the things where we have failed and we have done wrong, and we bring them to the Lord, knowing that he will pardon. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. And now we're going to worship. The group are going to lead us with, I will sing the wondrous story first, and then My Lighthouse.
Story of the Christ who
As part of our working it out, I'm going to tell you a story. As some of you know, we've just been on holiday. And we were really looking forward to the holiday. We really felt we needed it. I'm sure some of you can identify. And it was all booked. We were due to go on a Wednesday. The Friday before, our car stalled in the middle of traffic on Tavistock Road and would not start again. Two noble guys came and pushed us to the side, and we called the AA. Of course, by the time the AA man came, it started. So he saw us home and told us to get the car checked out. We arranged for it to go to the garage on the Tuesday. On the Saturday, we got in a message to say that our flight had been cancelled. But we had booked through a holiday company, and so it was their job to sort it out. They said they'd be back to us on the Monday. On the Monday, they let us know that, yes, they had booked us another flight. There were just one or two hitches about that. It was flying to Verona rather than Milan, which meant we would have a three-hour journey at the other end rather than one, but that was a small problem. The other problem was that instead of going at 1 o'clock in the middle of the day, it was going at 6 in the morning. So we needed to be at Bristol Airport at 3. We don't like driving in the dark. So we started on a whole range of possibilities. No, we wouldn't get a car to drive us there, not at that notice. So we realised that we could stay near Bristol Airport. We could go the day before. We cancelled a few things and then put them back again in various orders. But we managed to sort of get it put together. We had, of course, then to battle through checking online for the new flights. The one going out came up, and then later in the day, the one coming back came up, and we had to do all of that. We were at about the limits of our internet abilities. We then, of course, had to change the car parking so that we got there 6 hours earlier. There were quite a few things on the way. Well, we made it, 3 o'clock in the morning at Bristol Airport. It was heaving, but there was always somebody there to show us what to do next, to sort things out. And we got on the plane at the time they had said. And then the pilot came on and said, "We're very sorry, but the Swiss air traffic control is down completely, which means we can't fly over Switzerland. So we have to reroute, and that will take us some time. It might be 3 hours." We're on the plane at this point. Thankfully, it was only an hour. And from then on, I think things went pretty well. And the holiday was wonderful. Why am I telling you this? I think because it's a bit like life can be, isn't it? There are times when we're really getting to something important and everything goes wrong. And we realise we're actually in a battle. This is a spiritual battle. We really did believe that the devil was trying to stop us going. And there are all the things that you do. Of course, we were sending up frantic prayers all the way through this for every next thing that came along. Of course, we believed that God wanted us to go. But at the same time, it's not a question of just sitting back, is it? Sometimes you have to give it all that you can. You have to not only pray, but also go for it. Work out what you can do. Use what opportunities and gifts you have. And then you ask for help. On the Tuesday, we got to, Auntie Jane came and helped us out by taking Tim back to the garage in Plimpton to pick up the car, which had been checked over. We were still a bit nervous about the car, but it did fine. So, you know, life can be like this. We have to remember we are in a battle. So let's turn to our words for the working it out section. We have this treasure. We have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed, perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted, but not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed. May our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and by his grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope, encourage our hearts and strengthen us in every good deed and word. And now we're going to sing "Breathe on Me, Breath of God," and then we will follow that with the readings and the sermon.
Breathe on me, breath of God, fill me with This is Psalm 66, a psalm of David. Shout for joy to God, all the earth. Sing the glory of his name. Make his praise glorious. Say to God, how awesome are your deeds. So great is your power that your enemies cringe before you. All the earth bows down to you. They sing praise to you. They sing the praises of your name. Come and see what God has done, his awesome deeds for mankind. He turned the sea into dry land. They passed through the waters on foot. Come, let us rejoice in him. He rules forever by his power. His eyes watch the nations. Let not the rebellious rise up against him. Praise our God, all peoples. Let the sound of his praise be heard. This is the word of the Lord.
Jesus sends out the 72. After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them two by two ahead of him to every town and place where he was about to go. He told them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. Go, I am sending you out like lambs among the wolves. Do not take a purse or bag or sandals, and do not greet anyone on the road. When you enter a house, first say, 'Peace to this house.' If someone who promotes peace is there, your peace will rest on them. If not, it will return to you. Stay there, eating and drinking whatever they give you, for the worker deserves his wages. Do not move around from house to house. When you enter a town and are welcomed, eat what is offered to you. Heal the sick who are there and tell them, 'The kingdom of God has come near to you.' But when you enter a town and are not welcomed, go into its streets and say, 'Even the dust of your town we wipe from our feet as a warning to you. Be sure of this, the kingdom of God has come near.'" This is the word of the Lord.
Heavenly Father, we pray that you will speak to us now through your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, this is the sermon that Tim had prepared, so I do my best to do it justice. Jesus said to the 72 disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest to send out workers into his harvest field." And he gives them instructions. They're to travel in pairs so they can support and encourage each other. One talks and the other prays. Good plan. They're to go and visit the villages and towns as evangelists, sharing the news of Jesus' salvation and healing. And Jesus assures them, the harvest is plentiful. There are people out there who want to hear the good news that Jesus brings. And we know that thousands of people, of course, were drawn to hear Jesus. And the task of the 72 was to find those who wanted to hear the good news, to seek them out, to bring them the good news, to encourage them to come and seek Jesus. They were to stay in the people's homes, they were to eat with them, talk with them, and bring them the Lord's salvation. There were 72. They were to pray the Lord of the harvest to send out many more into the harvest field. And they believed that that prayer was going to be answered, so they travelled from one village to another, going out looking for those people who were responding to the good news of Jesus, and who would want to respond to the message, and that they would want to go out and share that good news to others. No doubt, folk people would be responding to that message. People's lives would be transformed. People would be healed. And the people in the village wouldn't want them to leave. And some would then want to go on with them to the next village that they were going to. It's often said that faith is not taught, but caught. Just being with the disciples would change attitudes and heart. They would learn from them just by sharing lives together. How do you recognise who those people are that might respond? Well, it might be quite a direct approach. Sometimes just a gut reaction, a nudge, that you know that you have to talk to that person. A little while ago, Tim was with the group witnessing outside McColl's in West Park. And he was standing away from the other group. He was outside the bargain booze shop. And a family were arriving by car. And he watched as the husband got out. And somehow he felt he needed to go and speak to him. So he fished in his pocket. He got one of those little tiny wooden crosses that we have in church. And he offered it to him. And the man replied, "Well, we need all the help we can get." By this time, the family had got out of the car and they were a bit further down. And Tim was able to go and pray for the whole family. We never quite know, but we need to listen for those nudges that say, "Well, just go and talk to that person." Something simple like that. The disciples were to stay with those that they were bringing the gospel to. With the Jews, it was very strong. They were very strong on hospitality. When somebody was travelling, it was the thing that they really should be doing, was inviting people into their homes. So when these disciples went out, they visited a village and they looked for a home where they would be welcomed. They prayed for God's peace to rest on that home, and they were to stay there and to eat and drink with them. They were told not to move around. They were to take time with that family. And perhaps that's something we need to learn, like any friendship. You have to invest time. Maybe sharing a meal together, it changes lives. Of course, it's something that we've not been able to do to the same extent during COVID. And maybe it's not always easy now. But we need to find ways when that we can invest time with people, even if it's on the phone. Like the 12 who'd gone before them, they were sent out to preach the kingdom, to heal the sick, and to cast out evil. And so often we don't realise that we're in a spiritual battle. And of course that battle hots up when people are coming to Christ or people are being healed. So we can't afford to drift because we're challenging the enemy. When the 70 came back, Jesus said, "I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven." That was what was going on. Whether they recognized it or not, they were breaking down dark satanic strongholds. When Jesus sent out those 72 disciples to preach in the villages, what do you think he was doing? I think he was praying. He was praying for those 72 and the villages they were going to. And he was winning the battle in heaven over these communities. He was winning a battle over Satan's hold. He was releasing them so that eyes would be opened to the light of Christ. People would be released from the darkness of sin. People would come to Christ and the sick would be healed. The kingdom, the rule of God would come. A battle was won in heaven, so the disciples could win the battle on earth. Satan was bound. Victory was won. And they saw this heavenly dimension. They saw the kingdom of light breaking into the kingdom of darkness. There was an anointing on their mission. They could sense God at work in special ways. blind eyes would see who had never seen before. Deaf ears could hear who had never heard the message before. Captives to sin would be released. They'd be free. They'd receive the Lord's forgiveness, have a new start. So the sick would be healed. Those who never walked could walk. Many who not been able to see or to hear were well again. The Lord had touched their lives. The dumb could speak, and they'd be bursting to tell people because it had never happened like this before. And when something like that's happening, well, people want to join in. They want to get on board with that. The laborers for the harvest come from the harvest of mission. So that it's those who've been touched by the love of Christ who become the next lot of laborers. They very often are the most enthusiastic. And we need to be careful that we don't dampen that first enthusiasm, to encourage the flame to grow, to be alongside those new believers so that they want to go further, they want to serve the Lord. They were warned to travel lightly. No bag, no bread, no money. Well, what bogs us down? We need to watch that. Is it a concern with church buildings and halls? Maybe, yes, they are very important at times. But can they drag us down too? We need to see that as a positive part of our mission. Belongings can hold us down. We live in an age of such consumption with so much stuff. I guess that we're all in that sort of situation. Our houses bursting at the seams very often. We need to stop things having a hold on us. Because there's a liberty to travelling lightly. And the less baggage we carry, the further we can go. So don't carry the burdens of the world. Let them go. Or the burdens of the church, for that matter. Leave them in the Lord's hands. And get on with the small things that we can do day by day. We'll travel a short way on our own. We can travel much further together. We need to serve the Lord alongside each other. And when we've gone further along the way, if our enthusiasm dims, we might get discouraged. We need to pray for each other and pray for ourselves that we need to rekindle that fire within us. Paul, writing to Timothy, says this: fan into flame the gift of God that is within you through the laying on of my hands. For God did not give us a spirit of timidity, but a spirit of power, of love, and of self-control. So come, Holy Spirit, breathe on us. Renew our heart of love for Jesus and give us a spirit of power, strength in the Lord, love in our hearts, and self-control to guard our lives and our conduct. We need to go around lighting fires. No, not burning buildings down, but setting people on fire for Jesus. To light a fire in Devon that no one can put out. We're going to sing now, Be Still, for the presence of the Lord. And then we'll have a little time of silence. And just to listen, just to see if the Lord wants to say things to us individually or things that you think need to be shared. So we'll sing first, and then we'll have a little silence. Thank you. If you'd prefer. Come, Holy Spirit, to minister your grace, to cleanse, to heal. Come to us now and speak the words to us that we need to hear. Father, we thank you that you are here with us, that you minister to us. Help us to go in that confidence that you give us in this time of quiet. Now we're going to say the Apostles' Creed. Would you like to stand for this? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Would you like to sit for the prayers? I'm going to use an outline of prayer, and there will be pauses in it, and you can add your own petitions either in your hearts or out loud as you wish. In the power of the Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, you promised through your Son, Jesus Christ, to hear us when we pray in faith. We pray for the church. We pray for Stephen and Caroline on holiday. Blessing for them. We pray that you will strengthen Bishop Robert, Bishop Nick, and Bishop Jackie, and all your church in the service of Christ, that those who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the world, your broken world. We pray for peace in Ukraine. We pray for countries where climate change is causing devastation. We pray for places that are so much poorer than we are, that have so little. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our local community. We pray for the healing of the sick and those who care for them, for Derriford Hospital and all our care workers of every kind. Pray for any that we know are sick. Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray that you will comfort the bereaved and give support to the lonely. Hear us as we remember those who have died in the faith of Christ. According to your promises, grant us with them a share in your eternal kingdom. Rejoicing in the fellowship of all your saints, we commend ourselves and the whole creation to your unfailing love. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And let's conclude with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And now our final song, You Were the Word from the Beginning.
Yours is the glory, yours is the name.
Love of the Lord Jesus draw us to himself. The power of the Lord Jesus strengthen us in his service. May the joy of the Lord Jesus fill our hearts, and the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with us now and always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.